Hello, Malty Mop the Hoople's. I'm Ralphie. This is Ralphie Review 336 in the Manx Bothy, in the middle of the Irish Sea. And thank you to Bertram for the Mop mention. Before I introduce this single malt whisky from Scotland, which I'm going to review and tell you all about, leading up to this, in my last review, which was a St. Patrick's Day review of an Irish pure pot still whisky called Redbreast 21 Year Old, I did mention that pure pot still whisky is a style of whisky specific to Ireland and produced at the moment exclusively at the Middleton Distillery by Jameson's. And essentially it's a combination in process and manufacture of not just malted barley, but there's a proportion of unmalted barley added to the process, which gives you green, slightly unripe grain-associated flavours, which are most particular. And I also mentioned very briefly in that review, 635, that Scotch whisky does not have an equivalent. For the simple reason, for Scotch whisky to be called Scotch whisky, all malt whisky must be exclusively made from malted barley. You cannot combine unmalted to the malted barley and produce something similar to Irish pot still whisky. And this really boils down to the entrenched traditional nature of the Scotch whisky industry. There is not a lot of room for variety above and beyond the orthodox recipe for production. And it works both ways, malt mates. It can be a good thing in maintaining consistency and awareness of exactly, by law, what Scotch whisky is. But the disadvantage is that there's aspects of Scotch whisky that we don't see. And I'm pretty confident that when the dreaded malt tax was introduced in the 19th century, to finance the Napoleonic Wars. It's all about money at the end of the day. Just follow the money if you want to know about wars. Scotch whisky producers at that moment in time would probably have combined unmalted barley to malted barley in the production of whisky in order to cut down the tax they were paying. It's the way it is. The nearest we get in Scotch whisky to a flavours and forms that we would associate and find reference to in Irish pot still whisky is local barley single malts. And I have an example here. I shall smell it, taste it, tell you all about it, and then I'm going to tell you some more. I usually do. Why break the habit of a lifetime? Springbank, 11 years old, bottled at a cask strength of 53.1%. So it's pretty heavy duty stuff, a relatively young version of Springbank. Natural colour, unchill filtered, just the way it should be. Approximately 9,000 of these bottles produced, which is a fairly restricted batch of whisky for the simple reason that Springbank, not for the first time, have brought out a particular bottling which has been made using locally sourced single farm barley. And although they don't go into too much detail, certainly not in the packaging and presentation, although you will find more information on Springbank's official website. The barley used is not the usual variety used in the production of Scotch single malt whisky. More about that shortly. Nose. It's a remarkably calm nose. It's not too spirity. It's certainly heavy in barley sugars, a little bit of a bright, fresh fruit malt note there, but not condensed malt that you would get in malt extract. This is lighter, it's more fragrant, it's more floral, herbal, and slightly spicy. There's a certain nuttiness as well to it, slight touch of almonds. I'm going to add some water now. It is, after all, at cask strength. If you've bought a bottle, lucky you. This is a serious collector's item. For those of you who've bought the bottle, if you're ever going to open it, you'll enjoy the result. It's a great ambassador for a local barley theme. There's not that many distilleries do it. Arran have done it, Bruichladdy do it, Kilhoman do it, and I know that Kingsbarn Distillery in the Nuke of Fife source quite a bit of their barley locally, and they use a particular variety called Concerto. The industry generally use a variant of Chalice, or Optic 2, Optic 4. Barleys used are constantly changing over time, simply to facilitate a higher yield. As you get a higher yield of maltose, malt sugar, right, which can be converted into alcohol, in my opinion, please note I'm saying in my opinion, the calibre of flavour diminishes. Because the more sugar you get out the grain, the less space there is for other constituents of the barley grain, like protein, classic example, to contribute to flavour. Just adding a drop of water, there's some beautiful grape notes coming through, some fresh Italian white grapes. Beautiful stuff. There's a slight mintiness in there, and a little sherbety note. Very nice, slight citric acid note, but confectionery sweet citric acid. Very, I was going to say palatable, but I'm nosing it, not tasting it. So it's very pleasant on the nose. Gooseberry, peach, some mild apricot. Lovely honey note, barley sugars. It is vibrant. It is distinctive. It is certainly more barley-ish than your standard single malt expresses. How about the flavour? Powerful arrival. Sour, bitter, sweet. Real great combination. Astringent, intense, golden syrup, barley sugars infused with chamomile, slight hops, very slight hop note, fragrant hop, more mintiness, butter mint. If you ever come across a confectionery called Buttermints, it's a kind of toffee, cream toffee sweetie with a little touch of mint in it. Getting that. Need to add more water. Very nicely made spirit, but I do notice that it's quite spirity. So really it's the cask influence is there, but it's really toning down and not contributing too heavily to the spirit that's come off the still. At this age now, previously Springbank have bottled the local barley variety of bottlings 16 years old, for example. They have had them at about that age, is considered a good age. But here it's younger, and I think it works in that respect because the experience they're delivering is a tangible, fresh spirit which is showcasing the actual calibre of the grain used. Sourced from a local farm just up the road, just a couple of miles up the road from the distillery, at a place called Macrahanish, which in my opinion is one of the best surfing spots in Scotland, if not Britain. See, the thing about that area, Macrahanish, it gets the Atlantic swells because it's no longer protected by the coast of Ireland. because we're higher than Ireland. Ah, that's better. It's almost a grappa type grape note to this. Grape skins. Delicious tannins, but it seems like herbal tannins. Rather than the tannins coming from the wood, it's as if the tannin is coming from the grain. Now, I can't confirm that. I'm just running with a kind of feeling that I get just through tasting this. It's quite bright. It's not particularly complex in the form. It's a steady arrival, good bold arrival, a fairly transparent, relatively medium development from the arrival, and the finish is fairly short, sharp, and to the point, but it has this infused complexity, a little bit of scented orange, scented pekoe tea in the finish, a little bit of tannins in the finish, but really kind of soft ones if they're cask sourced tannins. A little bit of lime oil, a little bit of grapefruit in there, a little bit of citrus bitter. And of course that barley sugar note is continuing really into to the finish. So a very charismatic, characterful, youngish single malt whiskey. I can understand why these have disappeared from the shelves of shops very quickly. It is unlikely now you're going to be able to buy a bottle, to be honest. But the reason, there's two reasons I'm reviewing this whiskey. One is because I know that there's those of you who've bought a bottle and you're not planning to open it, but you'd like to have an idea of how good it is and what it tastes like, in case you get tempted. And secondly, and importantly, I really want to introduce the whole genre of slightly invisible, it's not particularly well known, but the small distilleries who produce whiskey using locally sourced, lower-yielding barley varieties, why they do it, and why you should look out for them and experience them. And the very simple reason is to get the taste of barley, to get the taste of a lower-yielding, more flavoursome barley grain. That's the reason that if you can get a Springbank, look out for anything that you come across, say, from Arran or Bruichladdich, good example, or some of the small distilleries, as I mentioned, Kingsbarn. At the moment, I think your best bet for sourcing is Bruichladdich. Although, in my opinion, they bottle them at too young an age. My opinion. Marks out of 100. Out of 100. It's a malt mark. Why is it not 90? I'm bumping on, you see, about the fascination of the grain, more grain flavour. And it's a Springbank. Why haven't I given it 90 out of 100? And the simple reason is, I think if they'd even given it an extra year or two and still held on to the grain, it's still just a little fresh, a little bit nippy. It just needs more time in the cask to settle down a little bit. Settle down. 13 years would probably really suit this, because at that point you wouldn't be getting too much cask influence, but the spirit would be continuing to tone down, mellow, chill out, lose its heat, lose that little edge of harshness, which is in fact masking some of the intrinsic complexity of the spirit itself. There you go. Now you know. What more do we need to know, malt mates? I'll tell you what. Single estate or particular varieties of barley. We don't see much of it. It doesn't just apply to Scotch whiskey. It applies to, say, American bourbon, American whiskey. Balcones, quite notably, Texas distillery, by the way, in case you've forgotten, produced a baby blue corn whiskey, which in my opinion was absolutely excellent. It was a fascinating variation on the theme of corn whiskey because they used locally sourced blue Hopi corn, a primitive variety of corn which was more expensive to buy, and it yielded less sugar on mashing. It was difficult for them to work with, but the end result for the work they put in was a distinctive, unforgettable and charismatic bottling, which contributed significantly to establishing the reputation of Balcones. Likewise with Springbank, this is something they've been doing on and off for quite a number of generations. The local barley versions of Springbank have become really very collectible because they're generally good quality, they're small batch, they're occasional productions for the simple reason that the distillery is driving up the road for a couple of miles to a farm, walking out with a farmer, looking at a field with barley, which is not necessarily the typical barley you'd use for high yield malt whiskey production. It's probably a different strain of barley. It could be, for example, 2-row or 6-row barley. This is one of the main divisions in the barley family. 2 rows, I mean, they've both got 6 rows of seeds in the grass, because barley's a grass with seeds, that's what the barley is. And with the 2-row, there's 2 of these seeds in the row at the top of the grass are fertile. And it means that the infertile seeds are able to produce basically more starch because they don't have the burden of actually having to be productive. 6-row barley, all the seeds there have a higher starch carbohydrate content because they all are required for germination. The whiskey industry typically uses as high yielding a barley as possible. This results in more alcohol, less cost, and a bit less grain flavour coming from the barley itself. Local barleys, non-typical barleys, say for example Golden Promise, Concerto, or earlier Troubadour varieties, a really obscure one, which they're still out there. You have barley cultivators, but an awful lot of the old style of barleys have been lost. And bear in mind, cultivation of barley goes back 15 to 20,000 years. History is a lot older than the archaeologists tell us, frankly. But, you know, recorded evidence, you know, the Sumerians, for example, 5, 6, 7,000 years ago, you know, there's evidence because it's been documented that they cultivated barley. It's very nutritious. It's got a lot of essential elements in it, including potassium and solanine, which are very useful for human health. And early barley varieties have a high protein content. And protein, of course, is the building blocks of muscle tissue. So there you go. And it's always been a long tradition in Scottish cooking that the barley broth was your winter soup. It was any meat you could get, plus the bones, or everything into the pot, all the offal, the kidneys, the liver, everything. It made for a very nutritious, calorific meal, which was needed for winter times in Scotland. And of course, the barley is providing lots of protein, quite a bit of flavour. It's thickening as well. It's providing roughage and it's providing starch and it's providing essential vitamins, quite a variety of essential vitamins. Modern high yielding varieties have been genetically modified over generations to give more and more starch, which can be converted during the kilning process, the steeping process prior to kilning, to produce more sugar, simple as that. And when you taste these, you now have a point of reference, a local barley type of whiskey. You have a point of reference, particularly when it's not peated, because you don't notice it so much with Kilhomans or heavily peated whiskies. You'll notice it a bit. But here we are, a relatively unpeated Springbank. You really are picking up on it. And I'd point out, you'll see how much Scotch mist is appearing in the glass now. And it will get thicker, it will get mistier, because the proportion of barley oils in these local barley strains are such that they basically they contribute to a greater mouthfeel and viscosity of the liquor when you're drinking it, and in that way they contribute to the calibre of the experience and the enhancement of smell and taste. There we go. I hope I'm not. I don't want to get too long-winded about this, because in fact, I will have a vlog at some point where I go specifically into what barley is, where it comes from, and, you know, I'll show you a cross-section of a barley grain and explain the process. I'll do that later on. Enough to say that your old-fashioned varieties of barley, and the same can go for corn and rye, particularly rye, really quite unexplored. We just don't see that. And we should, because there's certainly demand for it. Springbank, when they brought these bottles out, they were selling for about £82 a bottle, which is expensive for an 11-year-old whiskey. But as Springbank explained, they're getting lower yields and there is simply more work involved and more man and woman hours involved in the preparation and production of the mash for distilling. That is the nature of using these lower yielding, higher flavoursome varieties of barley. But these bottles, when they appeared in shops, they didn't gather any dust. They were not sitting on shelves. They were going straight out of cardboard delivery boxes up onto the counter for whiskey fans around the world to snaffle up higher prices at times. I've seen these in major retailers, £105 a bottle instead of £82 a bottle, and people are buying them. And there's higher prices yet out there. I believe there's one little shop in Scotland now selling these for £140 a bottle, which is heading towards twice the price. Such is the demand for this particular style of whiskey. Now, it seems like a no-brainer to me that other distilleries are going to be onto an absolute winner. And it doesn't matter whether it's whiskey or bourbon or rye or whatever, even rums and mezcals. If you're producing using tangible, traceable, older, more old-fashioned single varieties of your key ingredient, and you're featuring it, and sure, it's going to cost a little bit more to buy it, but you're getting something genuinely different. Not just another rehashed marketing message. It's a real deal. And that is why this has been so popular, and why I hope that it's not too long before Springbank do this again. Because it's great to feedback a distillery into the local community, local sourcing, low carbon footprint stuff. It's all getting very, very relevant these days and increasingly affecting how we spend our money. This is opening up beautifully. It's becoming quite slightly eau de cologne aromatic floral. Grain spice. A really, really interesting whiskey. I'm Ralfy. Hope you've enjoyed this review. If you pop back for Whiskey Ralfy Review 637, I'm going to finally get round to opening this bottle of John O'Groats Scotch Whiskey Liqueur from the 1960s or 50s. I'm not quite sure. I'm going to give you advice on opening old bottles, the care you should take, the tools that you will need, and how to go about tasting and making the most and getting the best out of the experience of some scabby old bottle that you have found either in a car boot sale, because it does happen, or that you've picked up at auction, or you've inherited from a distant relative. Because again, these things happen too. I'm Ralfy, haste you back. I'm going to give you a wee wave bye-bye now. Are you sitting comfortably? Wave is on its way.